Hi everybody, my name is Zach Peterson. I'm a technical consultant with Altium. And today I want to talk about a topic that I think plagues a lot of new designers, especially because some entry-level design software can make this particular task really difficult. And that thing I want to talk about is how you actually design to a 50 ohm impedance on simple boards like a 4-layer or even a 6-layer board. This might sound pretty simple, right? Just look up something in the table, maybe plug some numbers into an online calculator. The calculator's gonna give you a number and you just design to that trace width. The problem is that you have to make sure that one, your board is manufacturable, and two, you're actually using a calculator that's doing an accurate calculation. So let's break it down and see how you can actually calculate this and ensure that your board can be manufactured as well. To get started getting to a 50 ohm impedance, we need to actually start with the layer stack up design. Then once you've figured out what your layer stack is going to be, you can design the trace width in order to get to a 50 ohm impedance. Now, a little earlier, I kind of slammed online calculators a little bit. I don't want to say that all online calculators are bad. They're actually okay for getting you a rough estimate of what the trace width should be. And then you want to verify that with your fabricator to make sure that they're actually able to produce the board as you've designed it. So first, let's look at the layer stack and see exactly what influences the trace width that you need to get to a target impedance. So here I've shown your typical entry-level 4-layer stack up. When I say entry-level, this is actually an appropriate stack up for high-speed designs. I've done 4-layer circuit boards that support DDR memory. So there's no problem using this if you design the board correctly. Here on our top layer, we've got our dielectric in between our signal trace up on the top and a plane layer here underneath. So here I've got a signal and a plane layer. And just for the moment, let's enforce some symmetry. Then I've got another plane layer and then signal. The design goal here is to determine this width, W. And my goal is to get to an impedance of Z equals 50 ohms. First thing you want to do is instead of just selecting a bunch of thicknesses for your prepreg and your core, what you should actually do is consult your fabricator first for their standard stackups. Now, I think a lot of designers will get into trouble if it's their first time designing a board. They will just run off into their PCB design software and start building a stack up. And they may say, oh yeah, you know, it looks good. It's that standard 1.57 millimeter thickness. And then they go over to the fabricator and the fabricator tells them either we can't produce it or we don't have the materials to produce it. We need to swap this out for equivalents. And you put yourself at risk of a design change. And so if you design for one width without consulting your fabricator first, the fabricator may come back and tell you, hey, that width doesn't actually give you 50 ohms. And then you have to change your design. So there are a couple of different parameters here that determine the impedance and the width needed to get to a specific impedance. So the first is our thickness of our copper. So I'm gonna just call it H. Really, it's the weight of copper, and that's how fabricators and everyone else in the industry specifies it. However, you can easily convert copper weight to copper thickness. So here's your key. 1 ounce per square foot copper is equal to 35 micron thick copper foil. Next is this layer thickness. Let's just call it T for the moment. So this layer thickness is the thickness between the signal trace and the reference plane. So this reference plane here is grounded. We'll just say it's ground for now. So you have these two geometric parameters, and then we have one final parameter, and our final parameter is our decay value. Or if you're like me and you're a physicist, you probably prefer epsilon sub R. So this value, your dielectric constant, also goes into determining the trace impedance. Now there's a couple of different formulas that you could use to plug in these different values to get your trace impedance. One of those is the standard formula in the IPC-2141 standards. And there's another set of formulas in a specific textbook. So I don't know how many designers know about this book. Usually if you're older, you do, because it may have been a textbook in your class. And it is definitely one of my favorite textbooks because I work so much on interconnect design. That book is Brian C. Waddell's Transmission Line Design Handbook. That textbook is available online. We've got a link to it below in the description. Go get that textbook if you want to be an interconnect designer and you want to learn a lot more about transmission line theory, and specifically if you want to see a bunch of formulas for different trace impedances. That particular textbook has a formula for this arrangement here. So for these microstrips up on this surface layer, that textbook has a formula for the trace impedance that is actually known to be more accurate than the trace impedance formula that's in the 2141 standards. Now, within a certain frequency range up to about a gigahertz, the two formulas are actually very close to each other. So it's okay to use either one. I always prefer to use the formula from the handbook just because I'm usually working at higher than a gig frequency on some of the stuff I use. You have these four parameters, right? The width, copper thickness, and the layer thickness, and then your decay value. And all of these come together to give you a formula for the trace impedance. Most calculators will just use the IPC-2141 standard. And that's perfectly fine if you don't need to worry about working above maybe a gigahertz or two. If you're working at lower frequencies, you can use either formula. Let's look at the IPC-2141 formula. Here we can see all three geometric parameters. Now, this formula is really nice because if we just set Z equals to 50 ohms, we can actually solve for the width for a given layer thickness and height. Now let's look at the trace impedance formula from Wadell's textbook. This thing's a monster. You don't want to try and solve this by hand because frankly you can't. The solution is actually the solution to a transcendental equation. So what you have to do is write a function of width on the left-hand side, write a function of width on the right-hand side of the equation, and figure out where the two values intersect for a given value of impedance and these other parameters. I know it's a tough process. It's something that if you're a physicist or a mathematician, you'll usually do in your classes at some point. You could also just start plugging in different values of T and H, and that will give you a trace width for a given impedance value. So what is the newer designer to do? Well, the first thing to do is once you get your trace width for your desired impedance in your proposed stackup, take it over to a fabricator. Your fabricator will tell you whether or not you're correct. And generally what they'll do is they'll just send you their preferred stackup for your layer count. So this is really nice and easy. They want your business. They're gonna give you that information and they're hoping that you'll produce from them. Some fabricators will actually make that information available on their website and you can just download it in your software's file format, import it into your project, and you're off and running. If you're working with something more advanced, maybe you're working at higher frequencies and you need to calculate a lot of different impedances in your layer stack, generally what you'll need is something more advanced than just the IPC-2141. A lot of PCB design software actually builds in an impedance calculator that's based on an electromagnetic field solver. So what this tool does is it calculates the electromagnetic field in your board for your given trace location and stack up, and it will tell you the width that you need for a given impedance. Now, this nicely extends out to differential pairs too, right? If we have differential pairs, I've got the corresponding trace up here on my top layer, and I've also got some spacing S defined between these two. So I've got two parameters that I've got to figure out, and you'll need a field solver for this. So your field solver that's built into your PCB design software's stackup calculator can tell you what this value is as well. Now there are some different empirical formulas that have been determined from a lot of experimental data that can be used to tell you this value generally for any value of decay. Just be careful with these and always make sure to validate your calculation using a more advanced stackup tool or validate it against your fabricator. Your fabricator will also be able to tell you the spacing required to get to a differential impedance if you're using differential pairs, alongside the width required to get to a specific impedance if you're just using single-ended traces. Rely on your fabricator. In fact, there's a well-known designer who I'm good friends with who always likes to joke, "Have you called your fabricator today?" Okay, folks, I hope that this has been very informative. This is one of those topics that I often see on forums like Stack Exchange or EEV blog. It's one of those things that I think can be difficult for new designers if they've never encountered impedance calculations before. However, if you use the right software, it's super simple to calculate the impedance and get a really good estimate that you can then take over to your fabricator, and your fabricator can validate it against their data. If you're looking for one of the best ECAD packages that you can use for PCB design, try CircuitMaker. CircuitMaker has a built-in layer stack manager that you can use to build arrangements just like this, send them off to your fabricator for validation, and then start working on your PCB layout. Super easy to get started, super easy to build up some simple boards, prepare them for fabrication, and get through the manufacturing process. Thanks for watching the video, and I hope you help us hack that YouTube algorithm. Hit the subscribe button, hit the like button, leave your comments down below, and of course, there's a link to CircuitMaker in the description. Thanks for watching, everybody. Have a great day.